Hi, everyone in North America and around the world. Here's Fluffy tonight. I am so grateful to hear from more and more of you in other countries. And since last week's broadcast, we broke through 167,000 subscribers. Thank you, thank you. My original goal was a celebration at 175,000 on the spring equinox, but we still have a ways to go. So I want to change our Earth Files party from next week in March to June 23rd for a summer solstice celebration, one of my favorite days of the whole year. And by then, with your great help, we can try to reach the 175,000 mark. And by then, perhaps we will also be close to learning more from the U.S. Secretary of Defense and U.S. Director of National Intelligence in reply to the congressional request included in the December 27th, 2020 COVID funding bill that directed the SecDef, as he's known in Washington, and the DNI director to give the public more information about unidentified aerial phenomena that fall into the categories of advanced aerial threats and foreign adversaries. And along those same lines in Europe, last Saturday, March 13th, Germany's Bild newspaper in Berlin featured French President Emmanuel Macron on the front page headlined, "Macron rehearses Star Wars." And Luxembourg's RTL Today headlined, "France runs satellite war game in a European first. War games in a galaxy not so far away." Well, what was happening? From Monday, March 8th to Friday, March 12th, the whole week, France carried out its first ever military exercises in space at the French Space Command known as the CDE in Toulouse. This was the first time that France, Germany, Italy, and the new U.S. Space Force came together in Europe to do war games about a threat from outer space. The simulation was codenamed Asterix, after a 1965 French cartoon character who was afraid the sky would fall on his head, sort of like the Space Command war games. Here was the plot line. High in the sky, way above human heads, an unknown satellite and other foreign objects came into near-Earth orbit. People had to be protected from sky attacks, from the unidentified extraterrestrial intruders. So, in this March 2021 war game exercise in France, the Earth Space Command fired anti-satellite weapons at the foreign objects orbiting Earth. War game participants also pointed out that another international threat are satellites from any country or foreign adversary that can be camouflaged as civilian, but are actually military-directed energy weapons. President Macron has said for 2 years that, quote, "space is the new area of confrontation, and having a weapon command center is necessary to defend ourselves in space and from space," he added, close quote. Meanwhile, on the ground in the San Diego and La Jolla region of Southern California, mystery boom shaking reported around San Diego was reported last Wednesday, March 10th, right before 5 p.m. Pacific time on TV and social media. Even in the Fox 5 News studio, some of the employees, quote, "heard the noise or felt the shaking both at the station and in Kearney Mesa, and at various work-from-home locations." And then within minutes, the newsroom received phone calls from viewers ranging from El Cajon to Ramona, close quote, and they were all reporting similar mysterious shaking, rattling impacts, along with sudden, strong hitting sounds. The San Diego County Sheriff's Department And the media also received calls from downtown San Diego and Point Loma to Chula Vista, South Park, La Mesa, El Cajon, and further north in Claremont and La Jolla. But the sheriff's department had no information about the cause, and neither did the U.S. Geological Survey, which did not report seismic data. Sonic booms, the U.S. Navy and Marine Corps did not confirm yes or no. Here are two Twitter reports. Mystery boom, 4:52 p.m. Pacific in La Jolla, shook window a bit on March 10th, 2021. And the second Twitter user included a screenshot of the 4:52 p.m. Pacific loud house-shaking boom that did show up on the Southern California Seismic Network seismograph, a cooperative project of Caltech and the U.S. Geological Survey. This morning, I was able to talk with one of the March 10th ear witnesses at his home in South Park, about 4 miles northeast of downtown San Diego. He is an independent marketing consultant and asked that his name be withheld, but he has now heard the same strange impact sounds repeating about a month apart in his South Park home.
I've now heard the booms twice, first February 16th and then the second March 10th. Both I was at my house here, but I was in different spots of the house. So on February 16th, I was sitting in the main part of my house, and we have these glass panels that open up completely and accordion to the side so that the side of the house is open, but they were closed at the time. And on February 16th in the afternoon, my wife and I were sitting there, and the panels shook substantially. It wasn't like, you know, because we live in an area where planes go overhead, but it was nothing like that. It was more of a direct hit of something. We looked and there was nothing. And then it happened again, and there was clearly nothing up against the panels because you could see right through them. So we thought it was strange. We thought maybe it could have been an earthquake. But growing up in Southern California, I knew it wasn't an earthquake.
You both heard an impact on the sliding glass doors twice a few seconds apart.
Yes, it was two consecutive, for sure.
Why dismiss a plane going through the sound barrier?
Well, it seemed more of like a compression. It wasn't a prolonged rumble. It was more of a boom, and then it kind of rattled, and then another one, a boom. And so, you know, just being where we are, we live under the flight path. It was nothing like that. And the only thing that I can compare it to versus even an earthquake, because of the sudden impact, was almost like a bird flying into the glass panels. Then that night, I saw a local reporter who had mentioned something, and I go, oh, wow, so it wasn't just me. And then he asked the Twitter sphere, anybody else hear these sounds? And I started looking on the replies, and there were people from all over, all throughout the region. And so I thought, that was very weird. It's very strange to me. And then when it happened again on March 10th, 3 or 4 weeks later, I was in my garage, which is maybe 30, 40 yards from my house. And I had my garage door closed, and I was working inside my garage. And the garage panels, which are a different material, more of like a metal material, responded the exact same way. It was more of a boom with a little bit of a shake, like almost like something hit it. And then the garage was then shaking because of the impact. And then it happened right after again. And I thought immediately, that's the same thing. It was the same exact thing. So now there's a pattern, and subsequently there's been more media and more news following up on it. So it seems to me like it's something going on, but I don't know what it would be.
3 days later, on March 13, 2021, I received an email from E. Simmons, who lives in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, about metal sounds in the sky. Phoenixville is a borough of Chester County, Pennsylvania. It has about 16,000 people, 28 miles northwest of Philadelphia, where the French Creek comes into the Schuylkill River. And here's what she sent me on March 13th. She says, at around 2:43 p.m. Eastern Time, March 13th, as she was writing this that day, and says it was about 10 minutes before she started writing me this email, we heard extremely loud metallic sounds like a combination of rushing, grinding, and reverberating sound, coming from the clear blue spring skies over my town of Phoenixville, Pennsylvania. The windows in my single-family home are closed today because the temperature dropped about 20 degrees overnight, but I was actually able to hear these noises from inside. At first, I thought maybe I was hearing something metal and extremely heavy being dragged across asphalt. But then I opened a second floor window and the sound was clearly coming from the sky. It seemed to be coming from the general direction of east-southeast. It would originate there and grow louder and then peter out and then return again. I've never heard anything like this before. As I was listening through an open window on our second floor, I noticed that our neighbor across the street walked out of his front door and looked up at the sky in bewilderment. I tried to get video of this from our backyard, but the sound on my very old iPhone did not cooperate. My husband was in Philadelphia while this happened, so I immediately texted him to ask what he was experiencing, and he heard nothing. The sound was not continuous. It would begin and peak and then wane, kind of like a huge sheet of metal being struck and allowed to vibrate or resonate with grinding noise thrown in. This is the only explanation I can come up with, but it seems inadequate. There was no musical quality to the sound. Since I grew up on and around military bases, I've heard sonic booms from aircraft before, and right overhead. Linda, this was not a sonic boom. It also was not the sound of an airplane descending. Sometimes that can sound like a fast rushing, but this was different. We live on a busy road, but the street noise did not interfere with my ability to hear the metal sounds. They were totally distinct. Is anyone else reporting metal sounds coming from the sky today in the southeast Pennsylvania region? And I could say to the general audience, has anyone anywhere in the world in the last month or two heard anything that falls into that category of the metallic sound being drawn along the ground, the sound of trains crashing? These were all phrases, all descriptions that I began hearing for the first time in January on of 2011. That is in Earth Files, where I've got 200 boom reports, and that if you go into them and go from 2011 as you come up to now, you will hear these descriptions that even include more musical trumpets, but it's that strange metal scraping and the boom. So in California, we had the knock, knock, boom, boom, separated sounds in the same week period that there was the strange metal configuration in Pennsylvania. And I welcome your emails to me at earthfiles@earthfiles.com if you have heard something like this and you have been afraid to ask people. The only way we're ever going to get to the bottom of some of these mysteries is for us all to not be afraid to share, but to share, and then we'll get feedback, and hopefully this we'll learn together. Now, I have been receiving reports from around the world since 2011 of these mysterious, unexplained loud booms, the metallic scraping sounds, other loud metallic crashing sounds like trains hitting head-on, and those eerie musical sounds that a lot of people said, it's trumpets, like in the Bible. Well, it's very interesting. If you do go to earthfiles.com and in the search bar, type in booms and do a search, you'll come up with at least 200 reports on that word. And there's lots of maps and images, and a few have actual recordings of strange, unexplained booms. And then there are all the other sounds over the past decade. You can type in trumpets and you'll get a different list. Beyond mysterious, unexplained sounds in the sky, there is another phenomena that was first reported to me back in the early 1980s, not too long after my documentary at the CBS station in Denver, A Strange Harvest, was broadcast. People would report to me, not a lot, but enough for it to be a pattern, saying that at night at the airport, they saw a glowing light that was distinctly not an airplane, but that it seemed to be coming down onto, like it was, like if there were airliners front and up in the sky, one of these lights would be coming down just like it was going to land like an airliner. Or in some cases, people said that they saw something like a disc and descending down toward a regular public airport runway as if to land. Well, somebody sent me a 3/4-inch video. We used those back then. It was from a completely anonymous source. The tape showed an airliner landing a few hundred feet in front of wherever the camera was operating from some other plane. And then you're watching the airliner going down. You can see the airport. You can see the runway. And then what comes into frame is a round disc in which the underside was clearly in focus. And it looked like this round craft here. The craft in the video had three smooth half spheres placed in a triangular pattern on the disc's base. It looked exactly like this photograph on page 65 of the George Adamski book, Inside the Spaceships, first published by a Canadian company in 1955. Adamski wrote that he took this photograph at 9 a.m. Pacific time on December 13th at his home in Palomar Gardens, California. Adamski said the black circle between the half spheres was a large magnifying lens used by the ETs that were in this craft to study Earth. Well, now, what I saw on that video sent to me anonymously, and I saw this with my own eyes, it looked exactly like this craft that you're seeing, which is from page 65 in Adamski's 1955 book. And here I have a video that is sent to me in the early 80s, anonymous source, no details, showing something exactly like this, coming into frame between an airliner that is landing at an airport and whoever is taking the camera, which is a mystery itself, and this comes into the video. And I remember thinking at that time, was the UFO in the video demonstrating, or maybe accidentally caught on film, in the act of purposefully gliding down a descent landing path just like the human airliner for some unknown reason? But why? And who filmed and made the video dub that was mysteriously sent to me without any attribution or details or follow-up? And then, 2 weeks ago, an account of another strange UFO, UAP, descending over a large human-made runway came to me from a retired United States Army Chief Warrant Officer 4, who retired in 2019. He sent me his DD-214 and other documents, but he asked for anonymity. One of his missions was to Tal Afar, Iraq, from March 2009 to March 2010, where the United States had a forward operating base, Sykes, located in the northern Iraq province of Nineveh, a few miles outside of Tal Afar. The base, with its 10,000-foot-long airport runway, was an outpost for American combat and tactical operations during Operation Iraqi Freedom. Sykes was regularly filled with Army rotary aircraft and Air Force C-130 cargo planes. One night, during his March 2009 to March 2010 mission in Tal Afar. He saw a huge craft above the runway that did not have a fuselage, but had a strange pattern of pearl-white lights, like a gigantic boomerang that looked like it was descending to land in a pattern of the other planes down onto the runway.
And I was the logistics officer for our unit to Tal Afar, Iraq, which is northern Iraq,
mm-hmm.
on a mission in 2009-2010. I did logistics for approximately 500 personnel. And we did the air support missions, Black Hawk helicopters, for all of northern Iraq. We did it for all services. I had approximately 60 helicopters. It was my job to keep up with who's got them and make sure they're serviceable and make sure that one goes down and the colonel knows about it. So as the war officer, I was probably assigned for about $500 million worth of property at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So in October, I went to the refueling point for our helicopters, which is at the other end of the airfield. Tal Afar airfield is approximately 10,000 feet long,
mm-hmm.
and it is as large as any of the international runways that we've got in the United States. It's huge.
And you're talking about October of
2009, and the runway itself is 150 feet wide. I was on my way back, and I guess it was about maybe 11 o'clock at night, no clouds. And I was walking back to my quarters, and I looked back, and when I looked back, at the end of the airfield, I'm like, what the hell is that? A craft, perfect boomerang shape, black, under each wing, like four bright lights, and then maybe a light underneath the center. And that's what I observed that night at the airfield, starting at the end of the airfield on the approach end of the runway that they were using that night. I'm a certified pilot, and Tal Afar is like 1,300 feet AGL. So I'm looking, and we had all kinds of heavy aircraft coming in and out of our base because we were a logistics hub for northern Iraq. So I'm looking, and I'm waiting for this thing to move, and it don't move. It's just sitting there. And finally, it starts to move. But then I see how big it is. This thing is like an eighth mile wide.
1/8 of a mile wide.
It covered the whole runway, just like it was making approach and coming for landing right down the middle of the runway.
The pattern was a boomerang, and were there four round lights on one side of the boomerang, four round lights on the right side of the boomerang, and one at the front for a total of nine?
I believe there was one in the center. They didn't shine down. They were just there.
And what color were you seeing?
A pale white, like eggshell color.
Right.
But it wasn't a real bright white.
Was it hovering at the end of the airstrip?
When I first looked at it, it did not appear to move. And then when I looked back at it, then it was moving.
So it was like it was suspended, and then it started moving.
That's correct. Very slowly, but the thing was, it was so big. What looked like slow to me, it was probably, I would say, maybe 5 miles an hour.
And to have anything that big move at 5 miles an hour doesn't make sense physically.
Right.
So what happened?
It just came straight down the runway, stayed at a pattern altitude, or a little bit below, and got to the end of the runway and made a very, very gentle turn to the right and then started rising, and then it was gone. This is some big damn thing, and it ain't supposed to be there. Who is it, or whose it is? But here's the thing. When it made that turn at the end of the runway, it turned very slowly and in a flat manner, not in a bank. The left wing didn't come up, right wing didn't go down, didn't do a F-16 or F-18 type maneuver. It was flat.
Just rotating.
Just did a right turn, went parallel to the runway,
and started gaining altitude, it wasn't going up like an aircraft. It was going up like an elevator. The thing is, this is real. I saw it happen, and it did happen. And they covered it up. But I thought, why in the heck would he come to Talifar, Iraq?
Right.
Why would he come there? Of all the places in the world for something to show up, why would it show up there, you know?
And if it were extraterrestrial, is the implication that huge boomerang was allied with the Iraqis?
I really don't know, other than it showed up and it was so big and so much that there's not a whole lot you can do about it.
And then the question is, why did the advanced intelligence in that boomerang go through the motions as if it were pretending that it was coming down onto the runway?
I just don't know. When I saw it, it made me think, you know, hey, what we're doing is pretty inconsequential. This is some damn thing. Very unusual.
Which is more the dynamics of the UFO, UAP, than our propulsion systems.
Yeah, not anything I'm familiar with.
And I hope that any of you out there, military service, who have also known that there have been suppressed stories about UFOs, where you've had your own firsthand experiences, to let me know, because I feel it is really valuable for all of us to keep evolving and learning together about the high strangeness of the unidentified flying or unidentified aerial phenomena. Because it's here, it's on this planet, it has been here for a long time, it's throughout the solar system, and it is way past time for all of us to be dealing with real facts about it. And do the booms, the metallic sounds, the trumpets have anything to do with a non-human presence on this planet? As it's been described to me, for at least 270 million years, there have been three competing extraterrestrial civilizations using Earth, using the solar system, based in the moon and other moons in the solar system and planets. And if that's the case, then would it explain some of the highest strangeness after a decade of more than 200 cases that I have dealt with? One of the strangest details, and it repeated and repeated, but it does not have logic, but this is what people would report. House A, three houses on the right, two houses on the left. Residential street in between, six houses across the street. I interview the Smiths in this house. They have even a crack in the cement of their foundation that was not there before they heard this tremendous boom, thought that something like a bomb had gone off. And they find the physical evidence in their foundation. It was off to the left of their front door. They felt the house shake. They are literally terrified, and they run out. This was a case where they ran out onto the street. And there's nobody in the houses to the right, to the left, across the street. Nobody else is coming out. And what they learned is they were the only house on that block who heard this tremendous sound, had the crack in their foundation. Another, Mark Wood, the retired Navy captain, he's helped me on a lot of the stories that have ranged from what's going on in Antarctica to some of these whole issues about the strange sounds and what could make them. And I talked with him when we were getting reports about 6-7 years ago, where some people would say the sound definitely came and hit the bottom of my shoe. It hurt the bottom of my foot. somebody else say, no, no, it came through the roof. And they would be in the same town, sometimes on the same block. Somebody, it came from below, somebody came from above. And one day, Mark Wood called and he said, Linda, I've just had the experience myself. He lives in Boca Raton, Florida. He said, I was in an upstairs room and there came a thump, a big heavy, like something was thrown against the wall, sort of what like they're trying to describe down in the San Diego region. And he said, I know it came from above and I know that it has to be a compression wave. It didn't come from below the house. It came from above and it hit only on one wall side of the house, leaving the question for him, the people on the street, where only one house, what's going on in San Diego. What is the force causing the energy to create a compression wave on one house in a block, one house in Boca Raton on one wall, and then all of these repeated bang seconds, bang, that have been happening down in San Diego? For any of you out there who may be scientists who know more about this, maybe some of you have been studying this and it's another one of the subjects that we may not be learning the facts about for reasons that are unknown. I would love to hear more from a lot of you because this doesn't go away. This is something that has been persisting for an entire decade. And here it is again. And in that same week, we get the reports from the San Diego region and then the strange metallic sounds in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania. March 10th, California. March 13th in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania. Does it have anything to do with interactions by technologies used by other intelligences that can work among us, above us, and below us, completely invisible to the human eye? So now, Ian, thank you for being there and interacting with the chat, and I would love to know what's on people's minds and what questions they have.
Hi, Linda. Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you to everybody who's contributed in the Super Chat this evening. And I'll just go through the names that I've managed to write down, although I may have missed a few. We've got Moonbird, Dave Goodridge, TNC, Chad Mitchell and Michelle, Alina, Cubino, Sonia, Terry, Smarter Than, Carl Balsamer, Caroline Boyce, Ron Schuler, Serial Dog, Carl Bittner. And a lot of people are wishing you a happy St. Patrick's Day as well, Linda. So happy St. Patrick's Day as well to everybody to our Irish viewers as well.
Thank you. Thank you. I guess I'm remiss. We were doing so much work today, and if you knew what other projects I've been working on, that I have been sort of disconnected from the cycles on the calendar for a while because I've been doing so much multitasking. But thank you. Why don't we, after the show, we can all get whatever our favorite drink is and raise a cheer to the world, to Earth Files, to breaking open the truth about our not being alone in the universe, and do it all tonight in one big cheer after the show for keeping on going, that we want to keep going together on Earth Files. So happy St. Patrick's Day to everybody everywhere. All right, what else?
That's a great sentiment, Linda. Okay, well, a lot of people are responding to the noises and strange sounds that have been heard in San Diego. Some people are even reporting that the sounds that they witnessed, the recent sounds, were of a trumpet quality as well, which is interesting. We've also got comments from people who are saying that in Alberta, Canada, They listened at one time for 4 hours. And I love the descriptions that are coming through here. Someone is describing from Tucson, Arizona, as though it was 100 garbage trucks compacting together. Someone else saying almost as though it's a shipping port with metal containers.
And Ian, please put out a request to those who have descriptions of something like the trumpet sounds. I'm very interested in, like they can give me street intersections so that I can do a map, because that's what I did before when the trumpets were occurring in 3 or 4 states at the same time. And there was definitely a latitudinal pattern. So I would be very interested to see what kind of geographic distribution pattern there might be for the trumpet sounds in Southern California or anywhere they're happening.
That's right. And I'll echo that anybody who has information should email Linda directly at earthfiles@earthfiles.com and hopefully provide that information exactly where they heard the sounds. I know from my own experience, Linda, that when I experienced strange booms in the UK, they seemed to be coming from the sky, but I also felt them in my chest at the same time. And I think people also have the same experience wherever they are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, up. Is it coming as a compression wave from the sky down, or is it some kind of an explosive energy from below ground that slaps the bottoms of shoes? They're both peculiar.
Okay, so I've got a few questions on this, Linda. Are there any reports of these sounds before? I think the first time when you reported them was in 2011.
Right. I don't have anything in my files before 2011 of what I would say, as I recall, I remember vividly where I was and where I was working on a story of one of the first and how they continued to evolve through that year. And it was as if in the beginning, the question, some people will remember going back to New Year's Eve of 2011 in the south central part of the United States, there were thousands of birds that were found dead on 2 different stretches of road on the same night that people were reporting booms that had nothing to do with the fireworks. And they made that distinction. And some people said, was somebody trying to cover up explosive sounds with fireworks that went off on that New Year's Eve? That was a question in some of the newspapers. And I've always wondered, because there never was a definitive cause given in any kind of necropsies that might have been done on those birds. Literally, I think if I'm recalling correctly, it's in all my Earth files, I have all of these by chronology in the archive. You just go back to January of 2011 and you'll find what I'm talking about. But I'm remembering something like thousands of birds were found after New Year's Eve night. And it was a big mystery. But simultaneously, people were reporting these loud, huge, booming sounds. And over the 10 years now, we're at 2021, there have been occasionally deaths of birds or animals somewhere in, let's say, the timeline of some of these events. It doesn't prove that they are connected, but it raises a question. What is the energy system, whether it's metallic, whether it's explosive, whether it's trumpets? Something is generating it. And that's what we all need to work together. The more we report, the more we can investigate, the more we may find out. So thanks, Ian.
Well, that was my next question, basically. We've got what are essentially 3 different types of sounds. We've got the booms, the metal or metallic sounds, and also the trumpets. The question was whether or not they are all from the same source, or are they connected in some way?
It is a good and profound question that has been in my mind for the last decade, and I don't have an answer. But with all of your help from around the world, if we just keep communicating more, we may learn more. So let's put this as one of those subjects that we don't know the source, but one of our challenges is to find out or figure it out. Go ahead. What's another question?
Hey, the other questions and comments are referring to the incredible report you've had from the United States Air Force officer who's witnessed this strange craft. Linda, would you say that this has some relevance to the craft seen over the Hudson Valley or the craft perhaps seen over Phoenix, the so-called Phoenix Lights?
The common denominator is something that is somewhat boomerang-shaped, that has light configurations that are not always the same. In this particular one in Iraq, he wasn't absolutely certain, but thinks, and he sent the drawing. So that's his independent work and memory, with the four lights on each of the panels or wing affairs of this boomerang, and then the one in kind of front and center. If we went back over the last 70 years, all the way back to Roswell and add another decade to Missouri, Cape Girardeau, if you started and putting in a piece of paper what are the most common designs? I think one of the most interesting anomalies is that at least in terms of documents that have proved to be solid and they've held up in history, that even in Roswell, that what was actually found and retrieved by our government was not round. It was described by ranchers, it was described by documents as being wedge-shaped like a piece of pie. So there, in a strange way, is the first pattern description that was not in the so-called category of a flying circle, a flying disc. And in fact, if you go to Kenneth Arnold's work, Kenneth Arnold was the insurance man from Idaho who reported flying along Mount Rainier that there were these nine craft and that they were skipping as you would skip saucers across water. I have an autographed copy by Kenneth Arnold of that book. And in that book was a photograph of an illustration that he worked with a professional illustrator. And those were not circular. They were curved in the front, and then they seemed to come in sharp wings and come to some sort of an inner body. And I'm bringing this up because this whole description of boomerangs, triangles, lens-shaped discs, curves that have the three half spheres underneath the bottom, long cigars, what I've just talked about in whether you're talking about the wedge-shaped like a piece of pie or the other. The boomerang is something that was not commonly described. Ian, I would say that it really didn't even come into historic discussion until the New York investigations, which were in the mid-1980s, correct?
Yeah, well, I remember the Hudson Valley cases because I actually know an eyewitness to that as well, and people are also commenting in the chat to that as well.
Okay, and I do remember that it was in the 1980s because it was 1986. I've discussed this in one other show in Earth Files, but it's worth repeating some of it tonight, that I was coming out of a meeting at a bank building, and it was in Aurora, Colorado. And as I went down the steps of the bank, it was 6 o'clock in the, and it was November, I believe. So the sun was quite down, and it was a dark orchid-y ink twilight that happens in Colorado. It's very beautiful, and the rocky silhouette against that kind of orchid sky. And I remember this so distinctly, I can see it now, because I remember that what I thought in my mind connected to what happens next is, oh my God, that is so beautiful. That's what I was thinking. And I'm walking toward my car, and I had a big leather briefcase at that time that I always had, and it was on a long strap. And I could see my car, I see the mountains, the twilight, how beautiful it is. And as I got to the what would be probably the rear panel of near my car, something just made me spin so that that briefcase flew out and hit one of the cars. I don't think it was my car. I think it hit the car behind my car where I was headed. And I still can associate that strong feeling of that spin. What was it that made me spin so hard? And instead of looking behind me, I'm looking straight up. And the starry sky was completely obscured. And it was a definite boomerang shape. And it was moving when the warrant officer in our video tonight talked about this thing was huge and it was only moving at 5 miles an hour. That was, I'm standing there looking at something that is taking up the entire sky above me. And it just seems to be moving, hardly moving at all. And there's not a single person in the parking lot. I am completely alone. And the last thing you want to do in a situation like that, or with me, I don't want to leave. I don't want to run into the building to have, I want to watch this. And here's the part that has always haunted me. Where it came together in the front, moving so slowly, was 6 layers of, if you could imagine, if you're standing outside of a hotel or an apartment that has balconies, and they all have those where you've got metal coming around in a terrace to protect people. And imagine seeing something that looks like vertical pipes or tubes or something that are showing each of those 6 layers that come to a strange boomerang in the front. And then all of those 6 layers came back and tapered to what looked like the facets of a crystal. Like if I went into a silver mine and I got a quartz crystal. Well, quartz has a very specific faceting. And that's what it looked like. I used to have a big quartz crystal collection when I was a kid. And at the ends of that big boomerang, that's what it looked like. It looked like faceted crystal. I don't mean made out of crystal. I mean the way crystals are faceted. And this is the other part. It's so huge. It's moving so slowly. And there was not a sound. Was it a hologram? Was something provoking with a hologram projection? Or is being able to be huge and move 5 miles an hour and then straight up and gone and no sound, is that an indication that when these sort of things happen in our matter world, it is a projection, a penetration from another dimension, another timeline, another universe, and that somehow the beings going through walls, going through ceilings, all of it, is because the relationship of Planck's constant that keeps our subatomic world in order, and why we can do that and our hands don't pass through each other, is Planck's constant. And if you are advanced enough to move from another timeline, another dimension, another universe into this one, and you can rheostat something like Planck's constant, then maybe that's where we start getting in to the kind of advanced physics that seems to be child's play to what comes in, takes over an entire sky, makes no sound, and it just drifted into fade. That one, my experience was not the many where they are watching something that is still like this, and then exactly as the warrant officer said tonight, here it is moving at 5 miles an hour, and it looks like it's coming in on an approach to that big runway, and then goes straight up. So many of the UFOs, their departure is from a still straight up. So that's just for openers. It's so complex. Ian.
Well, thank you for sharing that, Linda. It's interesting to know that you've actually had your own sighting for craft yourself.
Yeah.
With detail. Thank you. Okay. Someone else is asking, Linda, what you can tell us about what you know about the alien autopsy.
And I'm assuming that you're referring to the only one that I've ever really investigated and documented in Glimpses of Other Realities, Volume 2, my third book. And that is what is also known as the Santilli film.
That's the one that they're referring to, the one with the
six fingers,
of the alien with the with the damaged leg.
Yeah, and the six fingers. That was the big delineation between that type and before. All of the grays, most of them had always been described as having three fingers or four fingers. And suddenly here was film, allegedly of an autopsy, in which there are six fingers, and in the book I show with a graphic overlay, there are six toes, six fingers. And why I personally was convinced that this should be paid attention to started with a person in New Jersey. I lived in Philadelphia for a period of time from 93 to 2013. And in that decade back there, I also met people who had served in military or had worked in intelligence. And one particular individual who lived, I believe, in Delaware and went up and down the East Coast told me that he knew for a fact that the six-fingered, six-toed being in the Santilli controversial film was real and had details to share with me about that autopsy and what they found in the brain and the strange organs in the extended abdomen. It was like, not like a pregnancy necessarily, but an abdomen that came up and had very strange organs. Then in mid-1990s, that I got a contact with a man who had worked for the CIA, had developed terrible diabetes. When he got a hold of me, he said, I do not think that I will be on this planet much longer, and I would like to share with you some of what I know. And he gave me, totally unprovoked, no front loading, but he ended up talking to me about his seeing in a CIA, no windows building in a military base in the southeast of the United States, where they reported to the CIA in Langley and to Fort Belvoir, all things related to studies of films having to do with whether it's autopsies, retrievals, craft in the sky, all things associated with UFOs and ETs. And he said, when I heard about this film by the Santilli group out of London, he said, I saw it, and that is film that we saw in this military base. And he went much further, saying that he had been to Area 51, that the inside of the Papoose Mountain down underground. He described various types of not just discs that appear to have come from some kind of UFO retrieval, but that there was also technology that had been retrieved from the Germans in World War II, and that it was there in the same underground archive study, investigate structures. And when you come to the question of, if you listen to abductees, and I've done about 1,600 interviews with people in the abduction syndrome, you come away with, who are the tall whites? Who are the blonde Nordics with bangs? Who are the blonde Nordics that part their hair in the middle? Who are the ones that are 7 to 8 feet tall? Who are the ones that are 5'2"? Who are the ones that appear as humanoid lizards? Who are the ones that appear as humanoid alligators that make horses jerk and nearly knock off a rider? That happened in Colorado. And she told me back when I was investigating animal mutilations, when I rode my horse on a path going back out of the pasture home for lunch, and that horse came straight up and I was hanging on to mane, neck, muscle, and anything I could, not knowing what would happen. And she said, when my horse came down and I was holding on to the reins, making my horse go forward, there was, she said, at least 8 foot tall, looked like a standing alligator right around the bend, and that's what my horse was reacting to. Well, there's no follow-up. There's never any ability for humans to have follow-ups with these encounters, whether it's in a ranch, up in a mountain, on a lake. But they begin to gather because people from around the world, it isn't isolated to a town, it isn't isolated to a state. These descriptions are around the world. Reptilians, humanoids, grays, and I think today it is fair to say, no matter who the six-fingered ones were, or where their origin is, or what their relationship is with any of the others, it is very clear that the dominant non-human in the abductions are the grays. And today, in 2021, I'm pretty much convinced that most of the artificial intelligent grays that are in people's bedrooms and take them in a beam or take them through a wall, take them into a craft, they are artificial intelligence, programmed to do this, programmed to deal with Homo sapiens sapien on Earth, and they are doing work for something else. How high and broad do the progenitors go? And I don't know anybody who has that answer. If anybody listening tonight does, let me know. You can use Proton Mail, FedEx, Hard Mail. So, Ian, that is just for openers how complex the landscape is when we are not being educated and oriented by the power brokers of our own planet, who do have some of the answers. But we as a human species are left out And hopefully that is going to change and we will all start learning straightforwardly together, I sure hope.
That's amazing. Thank you, Linda, for that. Okay.
One more short question. I'm getting to the end, and
just relates to the report about the French news about the satellites. Do you think that Earth could effectively defend Earth against any hostile aliens? And I think people are referring perhaps as well to maybe that there may be some sort of a false flag information here.
Oh, there always is, but there also always is mixed in grains of truth. And the longer I have done this, the more I realize the two are often woven together. And the issue of what is the true state of our human ability to interact with militarily or hopefully with peace other intelligences, I think it comes down to what Lynn Buchanan described in that interview that I did with him about the friendlies, the neutrals, and the hostiles. And until we know exactly what our governments know about those three categories, we're speculating. So there's no question we have allies. And I have been told that the allies that we have from other places in this region of the Milky Way are very strong. And if that's the case, I don't see why we cannot just simply be told, just like there is on Earth. We have friendlies, we have neutrals, and we have hostiles. So it expands out into the Milky Way galaxy and the universe. So it's nothing new. It's just that we baby humans, I think we really thought that somehow Earth would be the only place that would have tribal warfare. But it appears that we're in a universe in which conflict and arguments between light and the dark probably seem to be universal. Well, that doesn't make me want to curl up in a blanket and run away. It makes me more than anything else want to understand the nature of my soul, you to understand your soul, and the relationship of being in organic life for a limited period of time with an energy body that may be eternal. And if that is the truth, and the non-humans know a lot more about it, I can't think of anything more exciting than hoping for a future in which extraterrestrials who honestly do know some of the big, deep secrets would begin to communicate with us and teach us. And that humans have a lot to contribute to exploring this universe. And that one of the reasons that I do this Earth Files YouTube broadcast each week is hoping that in our educating each other and working together, no matter what the governments do or don't do, that we can keep exploring. And so I want to say, as I began tonight, push that red subscribe button. Let's get up to 175,000 for the summer solstice together so that we can keep evolving with more and more and more people. No matter what happens the next day after that June show, that would be the summer solstice show, Friday, June 24th, is when the Secretary of Defense and the Director of National Intelligence is supposed to start filling in some gaps about advanced aerial threats and foreign adversaries. I have no idea what they're going to do, but I think those are substantial subjects. and join me on Earth Files YouTube channel. And we just keep every week trying to unfold with feedback from people who are coming with military backgrounds, science backgrounds, abduction backgrounds, sound backgrounds, and join me. So next Wednesday, I'll see you. Love you.
Turn on closed captions for YouTube videos by clicking the white CC button on the lower right. The default language for Linda's videos is English. If you would like to see the captions in another language, click on the white settings button next to the CC button. Select subtitle CC, and then select auto translate.
I don't have to put them in.
Select a language.
Bind them anywhere. They love.
And the captions will now appear in that language.
Sort of gone through, and they will hold their heads. I never had a cat do that before. And they'll pull against the comb, helping me get out snarls. And I think it's the best they've ever been.